first talk this afternoon is by Dr. John Warner, who, along with Paul Anastas, wrote the book Green Chemistry, and for a number of years worked in industry, worked at Polaroid, then moved to UMass, where he actually started the first PhD program in green chemistry. He's really devoted his life to this subject. And a little over, I guess, a year ago or so, he founded the Warner Babcock Green Chemistry Institute. He also started a foundation called Beyond Benign, which you might want to look up on the web. He has a very impressive list of academic publications, patents, all kinds of things. Anyway, I'd like to have Dr. Warner come up, and it's a great pleasure to introduce him.
I think the most important thing we need to do today is listen to one another. I think that that's what's been missing for the last 150 years of the history of chemistry, anyways. It's a pleasure to be here. I congratulate the organizers for pulling this very important meeting off, and I thank everybody for attending and being here. When I was asked to come in and talk about green chemistry and the relationship that it has with toxicology, obviously I was thrilled to do so, but also a little bit scared about it. I don't quite know how to approach this. It's something in our society, if you think about it, whatever you're really, really passionate about, it becomes very difficult to communicate because the passion and the intellectual components get all mixed up. If we were talking about a sporting event or something like that, or you know something, it's a lot easier. Or when we're in education and we're talking about some, you know, fundamental theories of this, that, and the other thing, it's easy to talk about things like that. But when it's talking about something that the implications are so great, we're talking about carcinogenicity, we're talking about birth defects, we're talking about wildlife. My God, everybody gets so fired up on this. We can't make a mistake. We gotta do this right. And that fear, that determination that we gotta do this right is one of our biggest problems, because the enemy of the excellent is the perfect, and perfection doesn't exist. And that is what we face. I went to a science conference a couple weeks ago, and it was interesting. It was just a standard chemistry science conference. And the first speaker got up and gave this brilliant seminar about this new novel synthesis of this interesting molecule. And they went into excruciating detail about the mechanistic explanation of why the nucleophile came here. And, you know, he was using a mercury catalyst to carry out this transformation. And then he's talking about how he had a very difficult time extracting it, and he had to use liters of chloroform to extract this material. All right? And he went on and on and on. And at the end, people applauded, and they asked questions like, have you thought of using the ethyl group here? Or, oh, it's really fascinating, the mechanism of that mercury catalyst. Is it, you know, an antiofacial, or is it, you know? And all these discussions about the mechanistic things that he was talking about. The next speaker got up, and it was a woman talking about this new polymer that she has that she's really interested in. It has to do with the stereochemistry and the geometry of it. Okay, and it was a bisphenol A-based polymer, and she talked about this novel new synthesis of it, and isn't it, and guess what? She came up with a way of brominating the bisphenol A to give it even better properties. Okay, and so people started asking, oh, have you calculated the rotational barrier of this bisphenol? Yeah. And it was all these questions, fascinated by the science. All right? The third person got up, and the third person says, I'm trying to invent an alternative for this reagent in the synthesis. People think that this reagent might be a carcinogen, and I've come up with an alternative, and went on to explain it. Every question after that was, well, what about the solvent? You're using chloroform, aren't you? What about the energy use? You're using the thing. So the poor person who identified as their intent to make something more environmentally responsible We're not satisfied with that intent. Now it has to be perfect. The first two speakers who didn't say they were trying to do it could talk about mercury catalysts, brominating bisphenol, and they were brilliant speakers. But the poor soul that said that they wanted to work on it, we're not happy unless they do everything. All right? How many times have you picked up in a newspaper that some company somewhere has come up with a new alternative product? And most of the feedback, oh, it's all greenwashing, they're evil, a company's trying to do the right thing, and we find it's not good enough. They gotta do everything. Close down. 38 years ago you did this, you're evil, you're bad. What do we do? If we can't just, we're in a state where science is an incremental process. We build on results. But if we are not allowing that process to occur, if our intent is to make sure that if you're going to do it, you got to do everything or do nothing, that's something that we really have to think about. Okay? So how did we get to this point? Why is it that we have this problem with incrementalism, and in this one special case, we're not that happy with it? Well, you know, 300 years ago, did we have the word art in the word science? If you think about it, was Galileo an artist, or was he a scientist? Was Da Vinci an artist, or was he a scientist? People were people. And then slowly, for whatever process, we can imagine the different reasons, we did come up with this concept of art and this concept of science. And then around the turn of the century, or a little bit later, we started to divide up the sciences. We've got physics, we've got biology, we've got chemistry. Then we took chemistry and we broke that up into physical chemistry, organic chemistry, biochemistry, analytical chemistry. Now we've broken that up into physical biochemistry and physical geobio, you know, hyphen, 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 hyphen. And really, when you get down to it, you know what the purpose of this compartmentalization is? To direct the paycheck at the university. Really, when you think about administrative structures, does it function in the real world? Do physiological organisms know that over here, oh, this is the physical chemistry going on, oh, and here's the analytical chemistry. We work together. Everything kind of goes together. And this separating it out, while at some deep intellectual level works, it also creates a little bit of a problem. Okay? So, I was talking to a chemistry department recently. You know, now being a former academic, I can be very critical about academia, of course. You know, Paul, you academics have to really think about the thing. That, you know, but we had a discussion in a chemistry department, and I was chair of a chemistry department. And I was reflecting one day to my faculty, and I was saying, isn't it interesting that the person who teaches physical chemistry categorically refuses to teach organic chemistry? They couldn't teach organic. And the person who teaches organic chemistry would never be able to teach analytical chemistry. And the analytical chemistry instructor says, well, that's what I teach, that's what I do. I couldn't learn, I wouldn't even remember any of that. And yet all of our students have to master all of these subjects to get their degree. So then, of course, me being passionate about these things, I said, well, let's integrate toxicology to the curriculum. Let's integrate environmental mechanisms of harm. Let's train our future scientists to know these things. And they go, oh, how is it going to fit into our curriculum? And I go, well, wait, you just admitted that you've summarily forgotten 70% of your education and you're a practicing PhD, and now you're saying you can't fit this into the curriculum? So we have these weird, weird dichotomies. Yeah, and there's the theory, and then there's the practice. And I think that, as Paul ended his presentation with, the worst outcome of this conference is that it's just a conference. Change has to happen. We're in the spirit of change this week, all right? Change has to happen in education. We can't not allow it to happen. Okay, and there's a lot of reasons for it to be difficult to happen, but it's got to happen. So let's step back and ask ourselves, how does a molecule come into existence? Okay, how does a plasticizer become a plasticizer made in billions of tons and sold worldwide? How does a pigment become a pigment and be sold worldwide? How does all the materials in commerce, did they come from? The myth is that somebody says, we have a need. And then we start scratching our heads as scientists, and we say, we got to solve this problem, get a group of people together, we need something that's right. It's actually kind of works the other way around. Typically, historically, through the 40s and 50s and 60s and 70s, we stumbled upon a material that had cool properties. Hey, look at this stuff. When it gets wet, it gets sticky. Look at this thing here. When it heats up, it turns blue. Ooh, look at this thing here. When you stretch it, it gets heavy. All these different physical properties. Then we said, what can we do with this? So we started with a toolbox. And then we said, what can we do with this? Ooh, we could make a cup out of this thing. All right, well, this isn't a really good cup. It's an okay cup, but it's a little bit too squishy. It, you know, when it gets hot, it gets sticky. Like, okay, well, if we put this thing in, maybe it won't be so sticky. If we add this to it, maybe it'll get more rigid. If we put this thing in it, maybe it'll keep the same color. So we started with some fundamental building blocks. We went down a path to make a product, and then we added things to it to make it work. All a house of cards in which if you change any one component, the whole thing doesn't work. And we went on and did that systematically to countless things that we now rely on in commerce. We say, okay, this product here has 27 components. We don't like component number 14. We gotta replace it, as if it's that easy. Just take it out and put it in. That's not the way it works, okay? The way it works, of course, is that it has intermolecular interactions with how it's binding to the polymer. It has certain electrochemical reactions with the air and with the pigments. And so just to pluck something else and to put something in is profoundly, profoundly difficult. But the seminar, the talk we heard this morning make it kind of sound trivial. Okay, so it's not that we're not capable of doing it, okay? The questions that people were asking, the brilliant work that we heard about this morning, shows that we have the intellectual capacity to figure these things out. But that's not the way it's always been done, okay? And so going back to these products, it's important to realize that there's two parts of innovation when a product comes into being. An engineer, the person who product design that makes that product, goes off into the world and seeks components that they're going to take and put into their design. What they almost never, there are exceptions, but for the most part, they never create a new molecule. They look for the molecules that are available to them. It is the chemists that are taking raw material from nature and assembling atoms in unique geometries that have never ever existed before, that supply the feedstocks to that construction process. And so there's a big difference, okay? When we talk about replacement technologies, alternatives assessment, and having people go through an excruciatingly detailed assessment of the risks of something, saying, we need to replace this. The assumption, subtly, is that that replacement actually exists. The tragedy is that most of the times, it doesn't. And that's where I become the most alarmed, okay? Because in today's world, who in their right mind would want to be a chemist, would want to make materials? You can't but open up a newspaper, here on the radio, all the scary stuff that we're learning about. In fact, over the last 40 years, the number of students getting PhDs in chemistry has declined steadily. The number of students going into physical chemistry and the material sciences is on the decline. So at the very moment society needs these alternatives, we have less people to invent them. That's scary. Why is it that this isn't this generation's Sputnik? Why doesn't every kid want to grow up, become a material scientist, invent materials, and provide them to society? What are we doing wrong in miscommunicating not only the need, but the opportunity as a career, as a way of saving the world? Okay, so we have this need to communicate this. And the question that Paul got, you know, about, you know, having, you know, toxicology and stuff integrated into the curriculum is a really important question. How are we going to change that? Because policy is doing really well. We've got, you know, I know people working in policy are not happy, and they shouldn't be. There's a lot more work that has to be done, okay? But there are strides being made. We have reached legislation in Europe. We see California coming up with things. The state of Maine has just come up with a new chemicals policy program. States, countries, people are coming up with these policies. My fear is that all the policies in the world, if we have all the policies in the world that say you must have a better plasticizer for this plastic in this pen, but there's no one to invent it, it ain't gonna matter. All right, because what is the hidden component of most of these policies? You must use the best available technology. Now think about that. You must use the best available technology. So an organization facing a decision like that has a choice. Okay, say you're a company that manufactures these pens. You could take a bunch of resources, pay a bunch of scientists to invent an alternative, or you could take that amount of money, pay a bunch of lawyers to fight the regulation. All right? Fighting the regulation's easier. Asbestos is still in the courts. All right? You know, in 2003, 2002, I'm not sure the exact year anymore, I'm getting old, DuPont's R&D budget was $1 billion. DuPont spent $1 billion inventing their next generation of products. The very same year, their environmental compliance budget was $1 billion. They were spending the same amount of money to make sure that they were compliant with all the regulations as they were inventing their future molecules. All right? So the CEO of DuPont decides, from now on, I want all my scientists to only invent non-regulated technologies to make safe, environmentally benign technologies. Not one of them has had a course in toxicology. Not one of them has had a course in environmental mechanisms of harm. If you're a toxicology major, then obviously that's part of your component. But if you're a synthetic organic chemist, if you're a physical chemist, if you're an analytical chemist, if you're one of these traditional chemists, it is very unlikely that you will ever have a course in toxicology, environmental mechanisms of harm. There is not one university on the planet that requires its students to take said course. We talk about such big issues, big things that are facing society and how we're going to do it, and you feel so small. How can I even contribute to something just so daunting as all of this? You know, I'm just one person. Well, look up the curriculum of your closest university. Go to the chemistry department webpage and find out what courses they require the students to have. All right? And then call the chair and ask them, why don't you require toxicology? One person, make one phone call. You never know. Something might come of it. All right? I see that happening. Universities across the country are desperately trying to do this. Okay, but it's all about the money. It's all about the economy. It's all about that, you know. How do you hire a new faculty member? Okay, you know, no one on the department probably feels comfortable teaching the course. Here's where collaboration has to happen. Every university that has a toxicology department, that has faculty teaching mechanistic toxicology, should next semester have a course that's offered to the chemistry department. If you can't pull it off that it's required, make it voluntary, make it public, and see how many people come. My faith in the next generation of students is that'll be one of the most well-attended courses at that university chemistry department that year. My belief, just do the experiment for me. Make sure it's publicly known, that the students know that the course is available, and see what happens. And maybe doing that experiment, the department will decide that, well, maybe we should have this course. All right, because Paul's slides, all the slides, you know, this morning, remember, the person who is getting their PhD and is likely going to work for Dow or DuPont or someplace like that will have never heard any of that, will have seen none of that. And as Paul pointed out over and over again, we have to close the knowledge loop. As we're extracting this information, as we're learning all of this stuff, if it's not being put into practice for inventing the next generation of materials, then we're missing out hugely, okay? And so we have to figure out how to close that cycle and to address these issues. You know, when I was considering becoming a chemist. As a 16-year-old kid, I went to university and I asked the professor in the chemistry department. I actually asked them, is chemistry dangerous? If I become a chemist, will I be putting myself or my future family at risk? And you know what their answer was? If you're asking yourself that question, get another major. That was the response, and I never asked myself that question for quite a while. All right, and that is, I hope you agree with me, a problem. All right, and it's not a rare problem. It is huge. So 2 years ago, I wrote the guest editorial for CNE News. It is the biggest chemistry trade magazine. And I wrote it, and I titled it Unintended Consequences. Okay, I was playing with people. I wanted them to think, okay, it's going to be the typical, you know, carcinogenic red dyes, birth defect causing plasticizers. But what I actually wrote about was it was all about how if we're not careful, we're going to lose the next generation of synthetic chemists. And if we lose the next generation of synthetic chemists, we're stuck with all the materials that we have today and we'll never have new ones. So wouldn't that be a tragic unintended consequences if we're not careful, we lose the next generation of scientists that are going to invent the it didn't matter. They got 11 letters to the editor the next week. Okay, and they were all the same. I used to gargle with benzene. Well, you know. You baby. You know, we chemists, all right, when you were in high school, probably some crazy person came and did a chemistry demonstration. All right, what did they do? They probably blew something up. That's what we do to kids. You want to be a chemist? All right. I've been a practicing chemist for 25 years. I haven't learned a lot, but one thing I've learned is bad. Okay, so if we're attracting students in because, hey, you can do this, you know, we're missing a point. Okay, but you say to a chemist, okay, play this game someday, go to your local chemistry department. You say, oh, last week I had to use hydrogen cyanide and man, was I scared. Count to three. Oh yeah? Well, once I used to use phosgene and that was a world war gas. One, two, three. Oh yeah? Well, once I worked with this material, it would take out a city block in a heartbeat. One. And we're like comparing each other's fears and dangerous stuff like the shark bites and Jaws. It's almost like, you know, we grew up nerds with the bullies taking the nickels out of our pockets in the kid playground, and so now we're dangerous. Okay? And so we come up and say, I'm trying to invent the technology that doesn't use hazardous materials. Oh man, am I ruining the fun. And so there's some things that are embedded in our psyche that the only people who are capable of coming to the chemist, taking them by the shoulder, and shaking them are the professional toxicologists who can match them blow by blow, discussion by discussion, calculation by calculation, and say, no, look here, this is the stuff that you're working with, and this is the consequence. And so to find some way to get us all talking together, as these people are doing an amazing job trying to make this thing happen, we owe it to them, we owe it to a lot of people to make it work. Thank you.